Okay, thank you. Thank you, Oscar. Good morning, and I would like to thank Oscar also for inviting me here to have this opportunity to present our work and to know this beautiful town of Trieste, this really beautiful place. Okay, yes, Oscar said, I'm from Santiago de Compostela, that grew around this big, more or less big, cathedral that somebody built there time ago because they thought that Santiago, San Giacomo is in Italy, no? Was buried there. So it's attracting pilgrims from all over the world at the moment. They think they are coming to sunny Spain, and what they find there is these cloudy skies that is very deep. It's much more typical there. Okay, we have a lot of rain, and in fact, we have so much rain that we have even a local set to transform something ugly, like rain, into something nice. That is, we say that Santiago is the place where the rain becomes an art, just to show the shiny effects on the stones or whatever. We have some sunny days as well, as this one, where they took the picture of our research institute. It's called the Ficus. It's got quite a bizarre name, because it's the center of research in biological chemistry and molecular materials, and it's inhabited mainly by chemists, so we are a little bit the outsiders there. Okay, but it's interesting because we have a lot of, a lot of relation with them, and we make mixed research as well. It's quite stimulating. Okay, but our main area of research is avian rhinoviruses. Okay. To introduce them, they are fusogenic members of Orthorhinovirus genus family Rheobatidae. They are fusogenic because they make this syncytia in the infected cell, and they cause arthritis and some other diseases in birds. Okay. They got a capsid that is made of two concentric layers of protein with icosahedral symmetry. This is the inner capsid here, that is composed mainly by three proteins. This pink one here that makes a sort of empty ball, empty sphere, that is stabilized by the green one. They acts like stitches, stabilizing the structure. And then there are these other proteins that make these turrets that are placed on the vertices of a regular icosahedron. And just underneath each of these turrets, these are transcriptase complex that is responsible of transcribing the genome. That is composed of 10 different segments of double stranded RNA. Okay. So all this structure, I mean, the inner capsid with the transcriptase complex and the genome is called the core, the viral core. And all this structure is sealed by an outer capsid and is finished by the viral fiber that is a trimer of a protein that is called sigma C that ends on a globular head that is the one that is responsible of contacting the cellular receptor. Okay. So the replication cycle of these viruses is cytosolic. It starts with a contact with the cellular receptor, enters by receptor-mediated endocytosis. So inside the endosome gets acidative after fusion with lysosomes. So that mediates the loosing the outer capsid, what mediates as well the endosomal escape of the core, that, as I said, is a transcription machine that makes messenger RNA in the cytosol that gets to different functions. On one side is translated, they are translated to give viral proteins, and together with the proteins they assemble to make viral daughter particles. That here's where the occurs the replication of the genome segments, and all the particles complete the morphogenesis and exit the cell by either by cell lysis or by cell-to-cell fusion, because it's a fusogenic virus. Okay, so in our group we spend quite a lot of years now in just trying to understand every single aspect of the replicative cycle of the avian rhinovirus. Okay. From the basic point of view, also the structures of proteins and all these kind of things. And some years ago, we were concentrating in this part of the replication cycle. that's got to be with the morphogenesis of the particles, that they occur inside cytosolic compartments or replications that are called like this, viral factories or viroplans, that are very easy to see in the infected cells. They look like this. They are quite irregularly shaped globular inclusions in the cytosol, and they are held by protein-protein interactions. Okay, they have no membranes or anything. And we learned, or we found, that there is a single protein, it's called mu NS. NS stands for non-structural because it doesn't form part of the particle, the bioparticle. And this protein is the one that it makes the scaffold or the matrix of the for these structures. Okay. We know that because if you express this protein alone in a cell, it forms these sort of inclusions as well that are similar. You know, they are not exactly the same, but they look similar than to the ones that are formed by the viral infection. Sorry. I have to say that this is not an amorphous aggregate of protein. They have a sort of order on them because the cell, you can see the nucleus is perfect, the cell is not dying or anything. And it doesn't react against them.
It's not toxic.
No, it doesn't, not very toxic. Okay. They are not trying to fight the presence of the inclusion, the cell. Okay. So we started to, well, we said, okay, let's try to see if we find how the protein manages to make these big inclusions that have some sort of order, and they are very efficiently, they are very efficient in constructing these structures, okay? So we started with a typical analysis of making truncation mutants, okay? Every little piece that we took off from the C-terminus of the protein was causing the protein to lose all the ability to form inclusions and make this phenotype here, okay? So we started to remove pieces from the amino terminus. This represents here, let me explain you. This is the red line is the full length protein, okay? These are the positions of the amino acids here. And these two bars are two predicted coiled coils that you find when you put the sequence of the protein in a bioinformatic program, okay? So they are predicted to be here and here, two different coiled coils. So we started to remove amino acids from the amino terminus, and we have these phenotypes here, okay? So in summary, what you find is if you can remove 140 amino acids and nothing happens, it looks just exactly the same. So this piece here, the beginning of the protein, is mostly involved in picking up all other viral components to the inclusions, not to construct the inclusion. And when you remove 381 amino acids, then you have this other phenotype, that you have smaller inclusions and they were more spherical in shape. Okay. In the middle, you have this sort of phenotype here that is amorphous aggregate. This were polyubiquitinated because probably the protein was not folding okay. So the cells were reacting strongly against the presence of the inclusions. There is also a proof that this and this have some sort of order on them. Okay. So this was like this until we reach 448. That is just the beginning of the first coiled coil domain. And anything that we remove further, it causes the losing all the ability of forming the inclusion. So in summary, we have the protein, and we can remove two-thirds of the protein from the amino terminus. So we end with these smaller and more spherical inclusions that we call them microspheres. Okay. So this is we call this protein that makes the microspheres mu NS minimal, which is the minimal part of mu NS that can form the inclusion. And we started to try to study this protein and see if we could find some clues about how the protein makes this sort of structures. So as I said, there were two predicted coiled coils in this part of the protein that we named as coil 1 and coil 2. So we call the bit in the middle the intercoil domain, and the C-terminal bit we call the C-tail domain. We were very creative in giving names to the domain. So we were trying to study how these domains interact to each other to form the inclusion. And we found that this domain there that is called intercoil, it's abbreviated as IC, it's got such a strong affinity for the microspheres, for the inclusions, that we could use them together in a molecular tagging system that we name IC tagging because of this IC tag. It's got two components, it's very simple, and it has many potential applications. We were not looking for it. The system works as follows. This is supposed to be a cell. Not. On one side there's this IC domain that you can use as a tag to put it to a protein of interest. Here there's the protein X in green. And the presence of the tag doesn't change the protein's characteristics. The protein or the protein's activity. For example, if the protein is nuclear, remains in the nucleus. If the protein is cytosolic, remains in the cytosol. Second component is the immunes minimal. They make these microspheres inside the cell. But when you put them together, you get all the protein of interest relocalized to the spheres. So it's a very simple method. It works very well. It's very efficient. You can put the IC tag in the amino terminus or the C terminus of the other protein. And it's got many potential applications. So this is an example with two proteins. One is GFP with the IC tag. It looks just that the same as without it. And P53, that is a nuclear protein, with the IC is again is still in the nucleus. When you co-express it with this protein, all go to these microspheres. So it's very efficiently working. So as I said, you can use this for many different things that can be placed in groups of applications. So we talk about a couple of them. The first group of applications has to do with the validation of protein-protein interaction in living cells. The idea is very simple. You want to see if a protein A interacts with a protein B. You put the IC tag to a protein A, send it to the inclusion. If the protein B interacts with A, without the tag, it will follow to the inclusion. Okay. So we tested it with two proteins that are known that they interact to each other, the P53 and the TLARG antigen of SB40 virus. And we put in just the tag to P53, not only P53, but also the TLARG antigen went to these inclusions. But as these proteins are nuclear, and we had some rest of protein still in the nucleus, we started creating a version of the method to work in the nucleus. So we have a more natural atmosphere or environment for nuclear proteins. So the idea was putting nuclear localization sequences to muones minimal or to versions of muones, to see if we can make inclusions inside the nucleus. We did that and it worked. So we have several versions of the protein that make small inclusions in the nucleus, and they work perfectly to make this relocalization of P53, and this time the T antigen all go to the inclusions as well. So we can validate protein-protein interactions in the cytosol or in the nucleus of living cells. And as you probably notice, you can use that also for functional assays, because you are removing a protein from their normal location by the interaction with a known ligand. So you can, and for other things, though, for example, Oscar in time ago had a brilliant idea of how to use it for a particular need that he had at the moment. Because it's very simple and it works very well. Well, try to find out how the protein is organized inside the inclusion, trying to see how is the structure. This is how it looks like just inside one of these inclusions at the EM. It's got some sort of pattern. It looks like fibers that they, I don't know. We are trying to find out how this is. And we are also loading proteins on them to see if that helps us to understand how is working and how it's getting organized. Well, these two videos are not great as well, because in this case we had a lot of cytotoxicity, but no, it was not because of the protein, but because of the transfection reagents that were a little bit bad. We had to repeat this. But you can see how the both versions, the full length protein and the Muniz minimal, behave in the in an analyzer. Okay, you see this one, the Muniz is really non-regular inclusions that stretches and shrinks and fuses and breaks and make a lot of things. It's like drops of oil. Okay, this went underneath the nucleus there, and it's fusing and stretching. Breaking is really, really strange. Well, this other one are spheric. Usually, it looks spheric, and it keeps spheric. They are still able to fuse, but they keep spheric. Well, it's nothing. Well, this cell will undergo apoptosis, but meanwhile, you can still see how they are spheric, and not that fusion prone as the other ones. But they are still able to fuse. Okay. This is another expression system. It's with in the baculovirus expression system in insect cells. Both start as spheres, but here's more difficult to see because the cytosol of the SF9 cell is very, very, very narrow. So you can see how it covers all the cytosol. Well, these ones are spheric, but at later times, you can see some examples of how it's still behaving as oil. How it fuses and breaks and wanders around the cell. So one would expect that this, when you purify it, it would behave differently, but our particles are very, very stable. Are really stable. You can treat them with a lot of things, and they are still with detergents. You see, these are late stages of the spherical ones, and they keep being spheres, bigger spheres, but they are still spheres. While these ones are making really strange things around. So this is a final stage. These are covering the whole cytosol, while this and as spheres, okay. The last thing is that we are trying also to label in vivo an infection, so we can follow how is this cell-to-cell fusion and how the dynamics of these factories are, okay. Because as we can put GFP on the Muniz, we can load GFP on the factories as well. So these are the factories here, looking in red, with a label with an antibody against a viral protein here, and this is how GFP looks like with isotat. You can see it in like focus in particular places that are probably reflecting the first points of nucleation of these factories. That probably, we don't know, but probably they afterwards they fuse together ones with other to form these larger structures. But we were still unable to catch them alive because of the probably because it's not easy to transfect and infect the same cells as you probably know. I think I went too fast because I removed some of the stuff. And I finished already. So just to show you, this is the people that was involved in this work. This Alberto Brandariz and Rebecca, they were the first one in developing the method, the first two guys. Then came Miria here, and now all the ER work is done by Natalia with a little help of Irene. And this Javier, that is the one who started all the lab there. And just thank the sponsors and all of you for your attention.